welcome to Latest TV News. I'm Mark Walker. Here are your local and national headlines for tonight. We focus on the economic recovery in our city and we look at how local businesses are getting back to work and adapting to new realities. I speak to the CEO of Brilliant Brighton and the Brighton Hove Economic Partnership, Gavin Stewart. I speak to Lucy Nordberg to talk about moving pictures. We look again at the Save Our Music Venues campaign. Plus, we catch up with Andrew Kay from Latest TV.
Now, for our coronavirus update.
There's a lot of discussion now talking about how we rebuild our economy, both nationally and locally. There's a big campaign that started, Save Our Venues, which tries to preserve the music venues that we have, not just in Brighton, but elsewhere as well. How do you think we can make that happen? Not just music venues, but our economy locally. What do you think we need to do going forward?
Now, there's a number of things that we can do. One is that we and others are calling on the government to make sure that the furlough schemes and other schemes continue, not until just the end of lockdown, but until places can get their feet back, themselves back on their feet. And that might mean some additional grants and support. We think that some of the small loans should be converted into grants. Rather than putting people in debt, we should be trying to boost them. But locally, we need to start thinking really creatively now.
What would you do in order to revive the tourism and hospitality industries in particular?
Let's assume that it will mean more staycations, we can hope, for the time being. And that might mean places like Brighton become busier. And I think that means that we need to become a city that can accommodate all different kinds of people, not just for the daytime visitors, but visitors for a few nights, family friendly, as well as, of course, the Stag and Hen do.
What about the national picture then? What do you think about the government scheme so far, the furloughing scheme?
I think the furloughing scheme has been very successful. Yeah. And I think the self-employed scheme has been very successful where it has reached the right people. The problem has been that there has been a number of loopholes that the government haven't been willing to accommodate, which I think is a great shame. And I personally think that it would have been easier and quicker for the government to have given a universal credit to everyone of, say, £1,000, £2,000 for the period and then claimed it back on tax. So those who continued earning would have ended up paying the £2,000 or maybe even a bit more back in tax because you would have adjusted the tax code.
Yeah.
And those who weren't earning would have then gained it and it would have reduced the paperwork. It would have got the money out to people quickly. Now, it didn't happen, and so it's a bit late to ask for that now, but I think there is some sort of questions around universal credit, universal basic income going forward, and I think there is some issues around making sure that we get things like universal credit right.
Thanks for talking to us again. All the best in the future. Obviously, we're going to catch up again soon anyway, so thanks.
Yeah, you too. Cheers. Thank you very much. Bye-bye.
I caught up with Gavin Stewart, CEO of Brilliant Brighton and the Brighton Hove Economic Partnership, to talk about how the city is recovering economically during the coronavirus outbreak.
Brilliant Brighton. Welcome, Gavin. Welcome back. When we spoke before, we were talking about how the businesses in Brighton might get back up and running again following the recovery stage of the outbreak, the coronavirus outbreak. Yeah, what about going forward in terms of attracting people to the city in the first place? How can we improve that, do you think? Because that's going to be crucial as well.
Yeah, absolutely. And again, it all depends on what the legislation is going to be around large gatherings and whether or not people can come here en masse. I mean, our bread and butter, as everybody who lives and works here knows, is ultimately we're a tourist town. People come here to enjoy themselves, and the locals come here to enjoy themselves. People come from outside of town to enjoy themselves. And so actually we need to be thinking about how to make it still an enjoyable place to visit, but a safe place to visit as well. We don't want to lose that at all. But looking at that ahead, I think we do need to really start thinking about what our events calendar is going to be looking like as we come out of this, whether that's just focusing on cultural bits and pieces, or whether we widen that out to more, just thinking about festivals, talking about science festivals, literary festivals, arts festivals, creative dance, so on and so forth. But also possibly looking at the wider city region as well, because where we as a city are certainly the honeypot, if you like, for people to come here, there is a certain amount of ripple that happens elsewhere around the region from that, from the economic benefit of Brighton doing so well. Our economic output is something like £7.1 billion a year, so we're a huge economic engine for the area. So what we want to be able to do is make sure that, yes, we survive, but also we don't want the Brighton and Hove hinterland to come into a state of demise either. We want them to survive too, because we're all, it's all an ecosystem ultimately. So there's possibly an argument to say, you know, if we're going to do something about supporting Brighton Hove venues, Brighton Hove events, then actually there's a wider piece about why it's really great to come to the Greater Brighton area as well. So there's a lot to think about there.
Yeah. Hopefully some of the events that have been postponed, thinking of Pride, for example, the Brighton Fringe, Brighton Festival,
yeah.
You know, hopefully some of those might be able to take place at some point later this year in some form. Because, as you say, we do need those events to kind of, as a kind of a thing where everything else hangs off of it, if you see what I mean, you know, like a, it's like a stem of a tree.
Yeah.
So we need those big events. So maybe I wonder what we can do to try and ensure that they do take place, or if not this year, then next year, and kind of make sure that people attend them as well.
Yeah, absolutely. And just on that note, certainly the businesses that I'm talking to on a daily basis, everybody is very keen that we do not lose our current events calendars.
Okay, Gavin, we'll leave it there for now. Thanks for talking to us again. All the best for the future. We'll catch up again soon.
Thanks very much.
I then spoke to Lucy Nordberg from Moving Pictures Theatre. She is asking people to send in their material for the From Home project, part of the Brighton Digital Festival. Here's what she had to say.
You're from a motion picture organisation, Lucy, and you're doing quite a lot during the coronavirus crisis to reach out to new audiences. Tell us all about it.
We met up with Tom Otway from Language Umbrella and the University of Sussex, and he was doing a project called Home and the Senses. So we were talking and thinking what an interesting location home is for people, and we were thinking about collaborating on something to do with that. For this year's festival, Digital Festival, of course, with all everything that's happened lately, the idea of home has become extremely significant and something that we really thought we should start the project on now. So what we're doing is we're asking people to submit videos of up to 3 minutes from their homes. The subject can be wide ranging, as long as it's got some link to home. They can talk to the camera just about what they're feeling at this time, or any message that they'd like to get out there. Or I've seen some amazing performances that people are doing online and seen some amazing cabaret and everything online. And so people prefer to do some spoken word, poetry, performance, anything. We're getting some really creative stuff in, even animation. So anything that people shouldn't feel restricted. And then that will be at the installation when we're able to present that later, and in a virtual installation if obviously the social distancing is still restrictive when the festival comes about.
And I'm going to do the coronation rap for you all. So here we go. Let me spell out my position. I'm 62 with a lung condition. Let's all try hard to avoid it till researchers have destroyed it. Don't get cranky, don't be a fogey, use that hanky, bin that bogey. This little rap's here to inspire us not to get coronavirus. Lady Gaga, Miley Cyrus, they don't want coronavirus. It's a disease coming on the breeze and none of us would like it, please. It's a disease coming...
So say I'm your number one. I'm living in my homesick home. Laughing at the static on my radio. On your ransom phone, clearing out the attic of my home sweet home. I found a second-hand Xbox.
In this video, we're just going to talk about the things we've been doing at home the past 2 weeks. We've also been baking. We made this today, our cheesecake. It's milk for our cheesecake.
One of my earliest memories is trips to my grandma's on the 12th floor of Pelham Estates. She died in that flat, in her bed. We were all there, After the funeral, I took a pile of her books up to Tower C, to floor 12. I couldn't get an answer on the door, but the superintendent let me in. I looked over to Nan's balcony and then her door. I saw the outline of a lonely figure holding a stack of books.
That's it for the first half. Join us for the second half for a discussion with Toni Amanda Coe-Brooker and an update from the one and only Andrew Kay. Welcome back to Latest TV News. I'm Mark Walker. I now speak to Toni Amanda Coe-Brooker about the Save Our Music Venues campaign, and we listen to some music from some local bands in Brighton.
You're the production manager at the Green Door Store in Brighton, but you're also the campaign manager for the Save Our Venues campaign. Welcome, Toni. Just tell us a bit about the campaign first, maybe, and then we can go and talk about a bit about the Green Door Store and why it's important to save our music venues.
So on Monday, we announced 107 venues that were at risk, set them all up with crowdfunders and put them under one sort of umbrella for the crisis fund. And over the last 3 days, we've managed to raise nearly 200k for music venues in crisis. So it's been going really, really well. But I joined the campaign and it has been chaotic. I mean, just absolutely flooded with people that want to get involved and support. It's been overwhelming. You know, we've got lots of record labels, you know, people who want to donate from selling books, from merch. Lots of artists trying to get involved. It's been really, really good. But like I said, we announced 107 venues on Monday that were in crisis, and we'll be announcing probably another 50 today. So I think the main thing to take from it is the sheer size of the issue at the moment.
Yeah, and they're in particular danger at the moment, aren't they? Because of the, obviously the coronavirus outbreak has meant that music venues, that they were some of the first venues to shut down, weren't they, in the end?
Yes, it's been a massive shock to the system. And being someone that works for a venue, I've just seen the whole of my calendar cancel for the next 6 months, which is really scary because we just have no timeline for when we can open again. The Music Venues Trust had just been able to start sort of like stabilising the whole thing. We actually saw venues starting to open rather than close, which was amazing. But then obviously we got hit with this crisis and it's like undone so much good work. So even from the aspect that, you know, Arts Council got involved and they were able to pull together a fund for grassroots venues, which, you know, have historically been under-supported and underfunded. And yeah, they put several millions together to kind of help venues, you know, buy new equipment, work with programming, basically to help infrastructure. And that whole fund got slashed when COVID-19 hit us.
Yeah, and that uncertainty just adds to the kind of the difficulties music venues are in. And we've experienced that here at the Latest Music Bar as well. So maybe tell us a bit about the Green Door Store then and the great musical acts that you've had on there.
We put a lot of free entry shows because we don't really want music to be a financial barrier to anyone. So we like to think that we're kind of working with lots of different groups within the community in Brighton and Hove. However, once a year we do an annual festival called 234 Fest.
Yeah, we're going to listen to one band now, aren't we? So we're going to listen to Libra Libra, and they've played at Green Door Store. So let's take a moment to listen to Libra Libra. I'm cold shivers, I'm getting aroused, you're core. You make it rain, so I can give it up. You make it rain, so I can give it up. So tell us a bit more about Libra Libra and why they're showcase the kind of the great stuff that you do at the Green Door Store.
I put them name forward because I just think they're a fantastic band. They're so like high energy and exciting to watch. They literally just give it their all every time they get on the stage. You know, I've seen them play to hundreds of people. I've seen them play to only a few people, and they always give it the same every single time.
and these acts, they need to establish themselves through music venues. There's only about eight left, I think, in the city of Brighton, isn't there? So
at the moment we've got seven from Brighton that are on the crisis list.
Yeah,
so including yourselves. So we've got Latest Music Bar, The Pipeline, Comedia, Old Market, Green Door Store, the Hope and Ruin, and the Prince Albert. These are all really, really important venues to our community. I mean, the Prince Albert is obviously like an iconic music venue within Brighton. And to have them on the crisis list is going to be a real shock for our local area. And not just not from a social aspect, but also from an economical aspect. You know, if we lose even one of these venues, that's going to be really bad for the economy in Brighton and Hove.
You've received some support from the government, or how's that been for the Green Door Store?
I think this is what's really interesting about working in the campaign. A lot of these venues have staff that are on 0-hour contracts and don't necessarily have to furlough their staff. And I've seen a lot of businesses around the UK that have just let people go. And the social responsibility from all of these venues is just, it's been incredible. They've all made sure that their staff are furloughed. They've all made sure that if there's possible work that they can, you know, keep paying for, that they will do. You know, it just shows an incredible kind of like strength, I think, from our whole industry.
So when do you think music venues might be able to get back up and running again? I mean, it's that uncertainty because we don't really know, but do you have any kind of timeline at all?
I think it's impossible to say. I mean, there has been speculation about June 30th for softening the lockdown, but that's not softening it for music venues. I think that it's possible that a few more shops will open. I mean, there's going to have to be a whole timeline of how, you know, how we can open safely for the public. And at the moment, Music Venues Trust are trying to put forward a really, really good plan for how we can do that safely, not put anyone at risk, and also not lose any more music venues. I don't think that we'll be looking to open for a few months.
Now for a catch-up with Andrew Kay. I spoke to him earlier in the studio to gauge his opinion on LGBT issues. So I'm joined here today by Andrew Kay from presenter Later TV News. I know you've got an update on an LGBT issue, which has grabbed the headlines quite a bit recently. What's the update? Because I know it involves Liz Truss, the Equalities Minister, Andrew. Tell us all about it.
Well, in a previous piece, we talked about the changes in America, where President Trump is perhaps trying to slide through a restriction on healthcare for transgender people. The Tory Equalities Minister, Liz Truss, is working on something at the moment in a new edition of what seems to be Margaret Thatcher's Clause 28. I think we need to be very careful about what is going on here, because I suspect that she will push this forward as being something in writing to protect young people who may in later life regret having transitioned far too young. But I think it's all too clinically phrased at the moment. There are people, I know people, who have transitioned when they're very young, and they have successfully done this and are happy. And there are people who have done it and are not happy. What we need to put in place is not a restriction on being able to do it, but we need to put in place the facility for people who feel that it's something that they may want to do when they're very young, put in place the right support, the right counselling, the right advice, so that they make the right decision at that time, not ban them from being able to make that decision at that time. And I hope that she will see that and put that in place, rather than putting in some draconian measure as Margaret Thatcher would have done. That's the important fact about this. Let's make sure that the right advice, the right support is there for young people who feel that they've been born in the wrong gender.
Just give us a bit of background to this story, because it's legislation. Is it legislation that's going through Parliament?
It's something that's come out of a recent meeting, a virtual meeting, talking about what should happen in the future. So it's not in legislation at the moment. But the statement that she made is provocative, should I say. She said that, "I believe strongly that adults should have the freedom to lead their lives as they see fit. But I think it's very important that while people are still making those developing their decision-making capabilities, that we protect them from making those irreversible decisions." So it's not saying we need to give them the right formats, the right forums, and the right tools to make the right decisions. I think the suggestion is that if you're not 18, you can't make that decision. I don't think that's right. I think people do know when they're much younger, but we need to put the right things in place.
This is a consultation, isn't it, I think, at the moment. Is that right?
It is a consultation at the moment, yes. And let's hope they get it right.
Yeah.
And Andrew, I know you've got some news about the LGBT community and Pope Francis.
Indeed. I mean, I've reported so many times on latest television through QueerSay on stories that are coming from the Catholic Church, and mainly they're bad news stories. But it really heartened me to see that in this time of crisis, Pope Francis has made a monetary donation to a group of transgender sex workers to support them during the epidemic. I mean, this has got to be an amazing statement to come out of the Vatican, that actually he really feels it's not just that they're gay, or not even necessarily gay, but they're also sex workers. I think this is a very caring moment for the church to be displaying, and I'm really feeling very positive about that. There's so much bad news on the LGBTQ scene about the crisis and how it is affecting people, and this was a good news story, so I'm really glad to be reporting on that.
Okay, thanks, Andrew. We'll leave it there. That's it for tonight. Join me for more of your local news stories tomorrow. Good night.